took a mic, camera, action. Yeah, okay, now I'm in the spot where I wanna be. Money spent, getting bent, chicks in front of me. That's the way I like it, money's turning something. I got a seat up in the cut and I'm burning something. Foodies dance around and I'm feeling ones. Off the top of the stairs and I'm feeling buns. Put some Lolo at the table. With this chick with the fat fatty and the ring up in the navel. Misses around, she slurs with the touches her toes and she can make a butt talk. Ooh, what you gotta do? I ain't mad at you, know a lot of famous women seen and that is you. You's a real bad girl and they need that. Sippin' on your handy, askin' where the weed at. Let me put you on a something. With a big no fun. Turn it around, let me see you something. Nigga, for real, it's gonna be something. I'm talking lights, camera, action. Let me sing out, I'm sorry, Miss Jackson. Turn it around, let me see you something. With me, for real, it's gonna be something. Yeah, I'm talking lights, camera, action.
I have to take a break for a minute, brother. It was getting real good to me too, but we got other people that need to come to the stage.
Oh, my bad. I'm disappearing.
It's not your bad. We all enjoying it. You know, you get into a groove and it get real good to you. So we understand. But show your love in the chat for Lamar Harris, AKA DJ Nooney, all the way from St. Louis, giving us some love and some good vibes as we move into panel three on day two, talking about Black Archives of the Future. He has been rocking out with his mixes and curating the slideshows that you've experienced for the last 2 days. So we have a debt to this brother for actually helping us make this conference and form what we wanted it to be, which was to create joy, to create community, and not us just being stuck behind our screens, but to be able to connect us in ways that brought about pleasure and memory and all those things. And so today, I am happy to introduce our next panel of wonderful women that I'm just ready to hear the conversation that they are going to have today. So today we have for panel three, which is titled Black Archives of the Future. It is Kimberly Drew, co-editor of the celebrated archival anthology Black Futures. And facilitating this conversation is archivist homegirl, writer Stacie Williams, who is with the Chicago Public Library, serving as a division chief for archives and special collections. And so in Black Futures, Drew, along with her co-editor, Jenna Wortham, pay homage to a content, digital and analog, that reflects the diversity of contemporary Black life. And today's conversation will touch on several topics, including what it means to document Black culture today, who has agency to tell Black stories, and how do we negotiate that content and formats and legitimize them when we're documenting Black life and culture. So I will turn it over to these two lovely ladies to get us started with this wonderful conversation. All right, thanks.
Hello, hello, everyone. Before we start, just want to say this is really just a continuation of intellectual work. I was jamming to that session, okay? Y'all set us up for a particular type of failure because my brother was on the keys, he was playing the horn, and we're just going to be talking about books, okay? So I just want to say a note of extreme gratitude for an opportunity to get into our bodies. Juvenile really has like ancestral energy pouring through him. and it's important to acknowledge all the many ways that we receive our data and information. But anyway, I'll let you take it away, Stacie.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Kimberly. This is such a pleasure. And I just wanted to thank again, Burgess and Holly and Makiba and Zakia for putting together such an amazing event and inviting us to be able to have this conversation. It truly is, as I'd said earlier on, you really are. I have a tiny, tiny short list of Leos who I follow on social where I'm like, that's that Leo? Yeah, you were that Leo for like a really long time. So definitely just an honor to be able to chat with you today. I too appreciate, thank you so much, Lamar. I appreciate a horn section just like every time, horn section. And I really appreciate what you're saying about like, yeah, how we're getting us into that body work, like moving our bodies. It's been think it, you know, just thinking in context of the book, it has been this really, it's been a heavy time. It was a heavy, you know, last few weeks where we feel it in the body. So even though, yes, I am at work today, I was moving in the seat. Thank you, Lamar. I did back it up. So with that said, thank you, first of all, for writing this book, because I did go back to it several times as we got closer to the event, but I found where it was really creating a lot of space, I think, for emotion for me was as I was reading it during the Derek Chauvin trial, and just thinking about staying focused on our futures in the wake of watching that trial for a man whose future was lost, was completely cut down. The book was really, I found it really grounding in that way. And so I think I'm so interested to know, I mean, even beyond the few early pages in the book where you all sort of break out the DMs in terms of how you connected, What were some of the events or things happening throughout your process, you and Jenna's process of putting the book together?
Yeah, I'm so happy to be joining this gathering. I feel almost like I'm very sober, but I feel almost high off of the opportunity to be in space with this particular community, because we thought so much about, especially those who share information the most when making this book. We thought about librarians, we thought about booksellers, we thought about familial connections, we thought about coffee tables, we thought about kitchen tables, we thought about bookshelves, because we wanted to create a book that could be something that you would be proud to have in your home. And it's interesting to think about it now, because our book came out in December of last year, at a point that I feel pretty confident in describing as, to date, probably one of the worst parts of the pandemic. Not only because we are still in the pandemic, but because especially for the Northeast, it was winter. It was this introduction of flu season. It was our kind of collective understanding that there would be yet another wave of loss and illness. It of course comes after this summer of uprising that feels all too familiar to so many of us, which didn't stop once the summer ended. And we worked on the book up and through the uprisings of the summer. You know, everyone out there who's made a book knows the work never stops. Mm-hmm. And so to your point, I'm sitting in gratitude that this book could be there for you in that moment. Because I think what Jenna and I have really come to realize is that while we thought this book was an offering, and in many ways, I think it is, it's really at its best as a companion. Like, this book is like, we always like gender the book as she, but like, this book is your homegirl, you know, like our little baby is your homegirl. Our little baby might be your auntie in that moment. But we really wanted to create a text that was alive enough that it could travel with you. And of course she thick, but like,
For those who haven't seen it, she's thick.
She's thicky, Ricky.
She's very thick.
But we wanted it to be, you know, by your bedside table, something, you know, that you could continue to go to, you know, from whatever vantage point you're viewing the world as a Black person. We really wanted to make it as global as possible. We really wanted to make it as multimedia as possible. And it feels just so perfect to follow that DJ set, because we were thinking so like sonically in the construction of this book as well. In the book, we have this incredible mix that was made by King Britt out of Seattle. Mm-hmm. Because we believe so much in like the mixtape as a format. And I know there was a mixtape conversation earlier today But I think that there's something so loving about a mixtape because it's so interpersonal and it's also so vulnerable. You know, it's like when you get past the aux and you play that weird shit, you know? Last summer I went to Afropunk and, or not last summer, 2 summers ago. Time is a myth now. Jill Scott opened her Afropunk set singing Creep by Radiohead and everybody lost their goddamn minds. And I was just like one, that's my karaoke song, so period. But two, just this like melding. And yesterday they were talking about the audacity, like Sarita was talking about the audacity of memory and building memory and cataloging. And we tried to make an audacious project, one that could continue to be with us. So that was my long introduction, but these just for grounding, that's really what we were trying to do.
I mean, I would certainly say you all accomplished that in a major way. That vibe you speak of where it's like, it's your homegirl, it's your auntie. I open this book every day of that trial. Like, tell me something new. What are you going to tell me today? The ritual for self-compassion and care by Sadie Foxy. Or even I had been, so you speak about the audience with librarians and archivists. The Digital Library Federation Forum a few years back had Rashida Phillips come speak. And it was the first time I'd ever heard her. And like, I don't know who else is out there who's listening, who has seen Rashida Phillips speak about quantum time futures and like, you know, resistance of the Western time clock is resistance to oppression. That it just like changed my entire mind blown. So I was wondering, just in terms of the, you know, talking about technology, we talked about tech. Yes, where are you, you know, where are these points that you're getting your data and other information from? How does it come to you? How are you analyzing it? So I'm really curious because definitely I think your work, in your work, you've talked a lot about being, coming up in the internet. I didn't come up fully in it. It's like half analog, half digital, but for it to have really been your canvas for much of your life, do you feel like as you and Jenna were working on the book, that your relationship to technology changed in any way?
That's a great question, honey. I mean, we worked on this book for 5 years. So not only did 5 years happen, but like 5 years of internet happened, you know, and like anyone out there who is, you know, not a Luddite up, you know how much Twitter changes, how much Facebook changes, how much, you know, a hashtag can start a revolution. And so we were witnesses to these things as we were making this book. But I should also say that this book really started as a response to the internet, which is why like on its pages, you'll see like it, you know, tweets and it just, and we have related entries that kind of operate almost like metadata. And so, yeah, it changed a lot because the internet changed a lot. The ways that we were using the internet changed a lot. You know, this book was born right as the conversations around Black Twitter were shifting. But we wanted to create this book really to say, okay, so many of our incredible cultural moments are happening, if not online, but as a result of our proximity to each other online. And so what would it mean to create our own volume that could hold some of those things? Because one, you know, as I'm sure everyone in this venue knows, it is impossible to record all these things, you know, like one of our we can't record it all. Like one of our biggest dreams was to have a conversation with Carla Hayden and just be like, homie, what y'all doing at the library Congress? Like, what's good for the internet kids? And in response, we were like, okay, we'll go analog. We'll create something that can be handed off, something that can be written within, something that like my Chick-fil-A fingers are all over this. Something that is a bit more tactile. So it changed a lot, but we, as both really learned about the internet, like my entire career is an internet born one, and Jenna's is in a very similar way, but from the aspect of like a tech critic, like she was in Silicon Valley as these things were being built. And so for both of us to take our hopefulness, to take our cynicism, and to take our Blackness, for lack of, you know, better way of phrasing it. We were just like, okay, we're going to do our best through practices of archiving to resist the waves of the internet, and really to try to sit back and just record. And so I think our relationship changed most in that we not only were observers, but now we were catalogers. Now we could take maybe a role based a bit more in agency as curators, which is really tight when you think about what it means, especially to be marginalized. What does it mean to say we have the right to be remembered? The audacity of being remembered, you know, just there's so much of this conference that's really about audacity and slipperiness and so much. It's just, I'm so honored to be in this space. I can't say it enough, because that's so much of what we were trying to imbue in this text.
I love that so much. The audacity of being remembered. That's, yeah, for those of us who do this professionally, this is the job. That's, I think, ideally the goal. And we've all been trying to come up with ways, I think, to do it more meaningfully, to do it in ways where we're feeling like we are more connected with the communities that we actually want to remember, and that that we ourselves are connected with the culture that purports to be remembered. I think what's really interesting about the book too, and I was thinking about it this way, because certainly, yeah, if you're an archivist, the way that you would think about processing this as a collection looks so different, but the durability of then simply taking it in a static way and having it in a book, that's really, I think that is really exciting. That actually is future thinking. I tend to think a lot of people, you know, look at tech as just something that's going to keep upgrading and going on and on forever. And there's really a lot of, I think, deeply meaningful, still analog solutions that we could be using and looking to connect. Shout out to at least this past year for like putting us back on the regular phone. Oh, I love a regular phone call now. like I think the tech itself is tired. The tech is shutting down. I can't keep a Zoom on longer than 15 minutes. I think it itself is fried. Like, we've hit the limit. So having this opportunity to, as you say, yeah, have something that will be on a bookshelf and still discuss, you know, in a way, our desire to be remembered and all of our complexity, all of the dynamic ways that we live and breathe here, I think is just really, it's very exciting. And yeah, 5 years. So you all worked on this, 5 years of internet history happened while you all were working on this book. What was an event or even a specific, you know, thing you experienced on the internet, like art or music, or dance, that just really stayed with you? Like, I understand in the book, you know, what we say is what we're going to keep are the things that really we can just carry. We carry it in here. We're carrying it in here. So yeah, I was just wondering what stuck with you from the book.
I mean, there's so many things. But I would say perhaps the best kind of like example that exists in this text is Jasmine Johnson's Optimistic Challenge essay. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of the process of collecting and curating this book was between two very different minds. Like, Jenna and I are really tight, but we're very different and we're very opinionated. And if you look at our birth charts, it's a lot of fight.
big fire sign energy, I understood.
yes, and she's a Scorpio, so it's just, you know, it's beautiful. But all that to say, when we were conceptualizing some of what the pieces, you know, the new work, right? So there's a lot of work that is pre-existing in the book that you will find elsewhere. For example, Teju Cole writing about Roy De Caraba's work originally appeared in the New York Times. But we commissioned original work from Jasmine Johnson on the hashtag Optimistic Challenge, which was made popular by Jay Versace on Twitter, I think. And it was just this like Black boy joy moment. And Jasmine is an incredible scholar of dance. And it was just this kind of like, we were both like, shit, this is like the perfect intersection of how to apply scholarship to something that's happening online in a way that doesn't privilege either. You know, like there's so much in the building of the book that we were like, we just have to, as much as we can, even this shit out, because that is, I mean, I think that's what it means to be Black at its best. I mean, the smarter that we are, the more connected that we are, the more we understand that these hierarchies are not built by us. You know, those hierarchies are the ones that decentralize, you know, Black women, Black trans folks. And so how can we make our own rules about how we want to be remembered? And I think Jasmine's essay on this, you know, tweet really, and this like broader, you know, viral challenge was so beautiful. And then, you know, and of course it echoes in this TikTok moment where you see all these kids who are making these incredible dances, and you see the difference between like the renegade dance and what happened to, I think her name is Peaches, the girl who did like On Fleek, you know, like the difference between those two kind of, so those two forces. And this essay just talks so much about, I don't know, it just feels really successful in its ability to straddle those lines that so many of us who are out here in the world are straddling, where you're like, this kind of reminds me of this, and it kind of reminds me of that, and it kind of reminds me of, you know, being at the cookout. Like all these things are so a part of who we are and so bombastic, and we would not be ourselves without them. I feel like my brain's doing a lot, but this essay for I think for both of us, and we both talked a lot about it, is just like this cementing of the idea that we want language that is approachable. We want language that, even if you don't know Jasmine's work, you know the challenge, or vice versa. And that's how the internet works too. Like there's so much of the internet that's like an inside joke. And so how could we create, you know, a series of pieces of information that would let us in on, you know, not the joke of life, but like, you know, when you're like, what are those kids talking about? You know, like something that could be like a key on a map for what's going on in terms of Black cultural production.
Absolutely. Language. So yeah, absolutely. I think language is one of those things where in terms of even with libraries and archives, like our languages is evolving, but a lot more slowly. Our language evolves way more slowly than say like internet language evolves over time. But thinking in that same vein of, you know, how are we as archivists then looking to capture what's actually happening in the language that is real and descriptive and doesn't elide our experiences, you know, language that would not purport to represent, you know, a Japanese internment camp, for instance, as something that is any less horrifying than the things that actually happen there. Thinking about how we, you know, are describing it, the change actually that happened even during this time, where you saw this more mainstream shift of people referring to Black people as slaves as though that was their, you know, born human condition versus you are enslaved. And even seeing how long that's taken to move. I'm seeing projects right now where it's like, okay, we need to overhaul our entire collection here on site because we refer to all these folks in this way and that's wrong and we need to change that. So I can really appreciate, I think, what you all were trying to capture and document with how internet culture changes language, how it changes so quickly and then moves into the mainstream. Shout out to Peaches Monroe, also from Chicago. Peaches the icon, pay Peaches, is what I've always said. Shout out to Peaches. Yes, language, okay. I love it. So other things about the book, what are some pieces, maybe because you all, I can tell you all took so much infinite care with selecting the essays and the commission work that appeared in the book. What is a piece that, what's a piece that you would have really, really wanted to see in there, but just for whatever reason, maybe wasn't able to make it, or a topic that you all had thought about covering, but you thought maybe it's just like too much and we're not gonna get it in here.
There weren't many things like that. Like anyone who's built an anthology knows it's just some shit that gets cut and we mourn them. But I will say in terms of timeline, Our book arrived in December, and Dionne Warwick joined Twitter in December of 2020. And yes. When I tell you that it to this day or November, I'm like, we miss Auntie Dionne. Auntie Dionne. Like, I'm still pissed. On Twitter. Like, it just.
Oh, wow.
And the Stallion, and this is Jenna's usual answer to this, but like, the Stallion freestyle existed, but we didn't really see the reign of Megan in the time we were making this book.
Mm.
And so it's somewhere between Megan Thee Stallion and just the Megan Thee Stallion sized hole in this book.
Yes.
And the Dionne Warwick sized hole in this book. As two things that kind of chronologically did not work. But there's many, many, many documents and folders and files of things that we collected and used as source texts that just, you know, like making any good mixtape just didn't make the cut. But I can speak other things chronologically that didn't happen. Because I mean, I also am like so happy with how she came to be. But it's that interesting thing. It's like sometimes you just gotta let shit go.
You do. You're cutting your darlings. You write the book. There are things that always get left on the editing floor, is what it is, for sure.
I had to call upon like some of my like art world aunties. I was like, yo, how do you stay in public when you're making an anthology when everyone wants to be in it or doesn't want to be in it and everybody's not gonna be in it? And Dr. Kelly Jones was like, some people are just gonna be mad. And I was like, that's good advice.
Fair. That's fair. That's what it is. As you were working on this book, so 5 years went by, 5 years of internet culture, 5 years of your life culture. One of the like maybe it was second or third to last pieces of the book asked, you know, if I am not visible, if I can't be visible, how am I really seen? So I guess I was wondering, as a writer and you know, and an artist and a model and doing all of the things that you do, were there aspects of your life that then became maybe more visible through the process of writing this book that you felt really strongly about, where it's like, yes, this is the self that like is coming out with this book?
Oh, I love the generosity of that question. I care a lot. Like, Jenna and I are really caring people. And it's not bullshit, you know, like there's a lot, I think, in especially in internet culture and value signaling, like, you know, I'm a healer, I'm a, you know, and all those things are valuable as things to communicate. Mm-hmm. And I don't discredit people who are doing that, but we're such soft people, like really, really soft people. Like, I don't fight, I'm soft. Okay. And I think in making this book, it was an incredible opportunity to wield the power embedded in vulnerability. Mm-hmm. Because we talked to our contributors almost every day over 5 years. You know, like there's essays in this book I was emailing for a year to get. Like, you don't talk to me about patience, okay? And so yes. being able to like usher something into existence and wanting to make sure that once it came to the fore that everyone felt really good about how they were represented. Like, there are pictures of people nude in this book. There are pictures of people being so vulnerable, or words that are vulnerable, or things that aren't, that don't exist elsewhere. And so being able to exercise that muscle of being a person for both of us, of being people who really do the work we do with love, and being able to do it on our own terms and not like at our respective jobs at the times, at the literal times for Jenna or me at the Met, like it was so nice to be able to just categorically make a book as Black women in the way that we like in tradition know it can be done.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that's a beautiful representation of of what you all wanted for the book and how you all brought your collective vision to bear, what it ultimately represents. One of the projects that were on, or the presentations that were on shortly before we came on, was a lot of really great, you could call them passion projects. Like one I did happen to work on, but the other ones, getting to watch all of them, that's that type of work where, as you're describing, that this, you know, this was this space in which you all created for yourselves to do this work and to have this emotion and share that outside of the day jobs, which it almost seems like that's like a really that's a really important thing to have right now, I think. But that you all use this book to create that space and safety. So I had a question too about safety. Some of the things that struck me in the book, especially around people revealing a lot of intimate and vulnerable things around sex work and maybe specific aspects of kink. And I think what was so cool about the book was thinking about the ways that the ephemerality of social media does sometimes provide more safety and maybe open up those spaces for truth, because the ephemerality of it means I could share this. And I feel safe maybe in sharing this because I know it's not necessarily going to live forever. So I was wondering a bit of how you both felt about that, like coming from this internet age. And yeah, as you said, we can't capture it all. Carla Hayden, the Library of Congress, were not able to capture it all. And generally, as archivists and librarians, which I'm trying to explain to people sometimes, like we have a finite amount of space. The things sit in this box, and we don't have a bigger box for it, basically. So how to think about what's important to capture when so much of what's on social media, it's ephemeral in a way, or it gets mixed up, it's nonlinear. How are you all thinking about that?
Yeah, many things. I mean, I don't believe in internet ephemerality. It's a myth. You know, it's like, we're here, it's going to a server, it's going to another server, and that server is connecting to you in Chicago, those servers are connecting to whomever or where they're watching. And I think that there's this big myth of ephemerality and disappearing online that we just, I think is, it puts Black people in such a bad spot. And so there's that. And then I think also it's interesting to think about the context of vulnerability and vulnerable sharing and how it is a shared responsibility, right? Like, we as collectors have to set up an environment that's safe enough for people to feel that they can share their truth, because there's no shame in their truth. Like, systematically, there's a setup of shame, but if that's your kink, that's your kink. You know, if that's your thing, that's your thing. And there doesn't have to be shame attached to those announcements. And so I think as archivists, as collectors, as curators, we have to keep those things in mind and do our best to not necessarily quiet our biases, but allow our biases to be productive, right? Like, I can't stand when I'm in space being quieted. Mm. You know, it's like that thing where people are like, don't say that. And I'm like, why not? It's the truth. It's how I feel. It's gonna be how I feel if I say it or not.
Leo facts.
And so it's,
yes.
And so it's like, if you want to keep me safe, then work within the space that might cause me harm. You know, if you really want to keep me safe, because my safety is not in my quiet. Mm-hmm. And so that, and then the latter part of your question, one more time, because I just got lost in the, I always get so angry at like the Snapchat thing, because I'm like, it's not going away.
Things come back, right? People are, you know, people, I suppose that's sort of the false argument of the cancel culture movement, that it's like, oh, you said this thing a million years ago. I'm gonna be canceled for this thing. But if the thing was true when you said the thing, it's not about canceling, it's about accountability. The thing was said, it lived in a space, it was like found and uncovered. So the second part of that was just wondering how you all were thinking about that or thinking through it. I think from practical standpoints, maybe archivists and folks who are tasked with capturing cultural memory, our biggest challenge is the you know, essentially just the resources that might be devoted to doing that work. You know in your head what it might actually take to get it done. But it's the kind of work that, it's the kind of work that it's really, really important. It's really, really important, but hard to communicate sometimes to people. Well, you know, we'd love to digitally preserve this thing. There's some really specific things about, you know, making this available that we, you know, making those kinds of decisions and being able to communicate, like you said, the care, the intention, the safety that should be in a space if people are going to come, you know, come look at our collections and things like that. Like, I looked at the citations. It's a, you all either like wrote out to every archives that had something hot. Like you all did an amazing job pulling citations and things, but just thinking about, yeah, someone at the end of that, that's always my favorite part to read in a book like this too. Like where did you all get your materials from? And sort of thinking through what that process was like for you. So knowing that there's a bunch of people on the other end of that citation who are trying to think through it. Maybe they don't always have the resources or they don't always have the support. So on our end, there is a realness to I guess just the potential obsolescence of anything. Like all of our stuff could go away if we have not put the money in to maintain and make sure it's actually good. You know, also again, I think it was cool to do it this way. This is here. This will not need a platform migration or an upgrade. This will not need a local server or a long-term preservation storage server to share that. So yeah, I think thinking about technology and what it means to share, what it means to be remembered and how you do that if you don't always have the resources, if they're hard to come by, if you're not able to be in the rooms where the decisions are being made about what we share, what we keep. So yes, yeah. That's awesome. That's a great
way. Well, one thing I would say for everyone is to absolutely look into, if you have not already, to look into Miriam Kava's work and to look into Adrienne Marie Brown's work, especially around abolition and cancel culture. Adrienne just published a book called We Will Not Cancel Us. And so I've been thinking a lot about those things and, you know, even the Teen Vogue drama. It's just, we have to be accountable and we have to be strategic because we are an imperfect body. And whenever there's a gathering, whenever we're in space, especially in pandemic context, there's always a potential for violence. And I'm just so much more invested in conversations of acknowledging that, mm-hmm. you know, like acknowledging what's lost in translation, acknowledging mistakes, than trying to pretend like we're some like omnipotent figure that could never do anything wrong. Mm-hmm. And then the second part of your question that I find to be really beautiful, I think a lot about like how we can decentralize information, you know, like how can we take the skill sets that we learn in a Mills, like IMLS, you know what I'm talking about? The mm-hmm. degree y'all got. Like how we can take those tools and skill sets and apply them to our own personal collections. You know, like you think about the collection at Emory, Camille, you know what I'm talking about? I'm forgetting her last name. Yes. But that family collection that's at Emory, like that started in the home, you know, or collectors are building, you know, out their own archives of art, you know? And I think we have to, especially as marginalized people, think about these ways of one, assessing our own value ourselves, because this thing is no more valuable because it is in the museum. That doesn't have to be the marker of value. If we want to talk about preservation, that's a different conversation. Or if we want to talk about something that like should be a part of a broader culture mm-hmm. or like a collective narrative, those things are amazing. But I think that we have to also be able to self-assign and self-designate the things that like are ours and are valuable to us. Because I think that there's few things more powerful than a bookshelf, you know? Like I know Stephen Fullwood was speaking yesterday, I think, but I think so much about Stephen Fullwood and in the life and how so much of queer, Black queer history is held in homes because no one wanted our shit.
Held in homes.
And so how do we then take these practices, which we can apply or amend to, you know, around whatever, you know, ability we're at or capacity we have? Those are the conversations I'm much more interested in, because like I'm a New Yorker and like the Schomburg can't hold everything. It just simply cannot. And it doesn't need to.
Yeah. Absolutely. I think I do feel like, and I'm really heartened to see this, Dorothy Berry, who's a fantastic archivist at Harvard, she gave a talk recently where she was like, you know, everything doesn't have to be in archives. It's like, you're a collector and it's cool. It is cool. Everything doesn't, we don't have to even actually put that label on everything, but we can share information with you about how to keep it safe. And that's totally fine. It's not mm-hmm. taking anything away from us as the library or us as the archive to share with you this really important information about how you're keeping, about how you're keeping collections in the home. So I absolutely agree. I think I definitely felt like the art background coming through. I mean, it felt like I was walking through a gallery, but on the page. So I could feel the manner in which you all took that sort of your personal background and skills, the internal biases that we all have toward the things that we, you know, love or think are important or want to advocate for, and yeah, built this really amazing ode.
I just want to say one more thing too about. Oh, sorry. I just wanted to add one thing too about private collection, because I was watching the other night. There's this documentary on Netflix about the college admission scandal, and I just can't stop thinking about it, because it's like, you know, Lori Loughlin, I think that's her name, like all these rich people paid this guy to get their kids into college. And that is not unlike what happens in museums and libraries. And so how do we also then take back some of that power? Because it's not an even game, you know? Like, there are names of people on walls and that didn't happen by mistake. And so how can you, you know, lean on and work collectively with the keepers of history, whether that be oral historians in your network, artists in your network, archivists in your network, librarians in your network, and to take those tools and make those tools more available to others around you. Because I feel like that is like such an incredible form of resistance. And it's like so in tune with Carter G. Woodson's entire principles and thinking about Negro History Week or Black History Month. Like, it is, you know, it's up to us. I mean, and I can't say it enough. And I say that with respect, of course, to capacity and ability. But like, we have to start seeing ourselves, or we can't expect an institution to do so. And fuck them institutions in some ways, like, I don't know.
No, we do have to start seeing ourselves in those spaces. So you mentioned Miriam Kaba's work, and it is very, very exciting for us. She deposited her papers at the Chicago Public Library. They're actually currently open for research, super exciting. But I think what's really exciting about that is, as you're saying, like, yes, as a contemporary voice for abolition, like, Miriam Kaba is it. And her work is so Chicago. It's so like based in this love for these kids here. Like, it's really an incredible collection, I think, to have and be able to take a deeper look into some of her work and into how she thinks. But it's also really, really exciting to have that collection and be able to sit in conversation with other more historical collections related to abolition, related to labor, related to, you know, civil rights, related to education. It's, you know, I think I feel really excited about trying to work with folks to build those connections and making them see, you know, we have this really, really rich, beautiful history, but every day around us, people are, you know, walking through the day and making their mark and doing what needs to be done and helping, you know, helping us all kind of keep going and being part of this collective story. So it's so exciting. It's so exciting that we have and can share those things. And even to know that, yeah, it's not so much that we have to have all of them, but to be able to see ourselves in space, you know, in big spaces as we are, and our, you know, bringing our full selves to the table. It's not compressed. It's not, you know, it's not filtered. It's not translated through audiences who are not us, but yeah, that we could just, we could see all of ourselves, the complexity, the beauty, the pain, and that it's normal that we see us, that it's not a, oh, wow, I saw this one Black person in this museum. I saw a Black artist at a gallery like 3 weeks ago, and it was the first, you know, what it was maybe the first Black artist they had doing an exhibition in like 5 years. That's, no, that's not, let's not continue. So I'm looking at the time. We have like, we have almost 15 minutes left. And it has, it's just, it's been such an awesome conversation. I really thank you so much for being so, just so generous with your time and your thoughts. What's next for you?
Ooh, today, I've been personally working on a Instagram Live series that is focused on the anti-trans legislation that's moving across the US. There are approximately 140 bills, some so nefarious that they want to remove trans and gender non-conforming children from their homes and charge their parents with Class C felonies. Some that prohibit trans girls from playing in sports that represent their, you know, gender identity. I'll put it in the chat. Yes, but please. I've been working on, I built a syllabus as part of this for people to learn. And anyone who goes to my Instagram page at Museum Mammy, there's a Google Doc in there. All of the talks will be sign language interpreted. And that's the thing that I've been really scared the most of right now, because it is, it's an issue that is of course on its face about trans and gender non-conforming people, queer people, but it is also so deeply embedded and connected to Black codes and policing of Blackness and policing of gender and policing of disabled bodies. And so it's just one of those things that I hope that all of us really take very seriously, because so many of the ways that these lines are being drawn are just, the code is just so against Black folks. It's just kind of like wild, you know, looking at athletes from Serena Williams to Caster Semenya as perfect examples where their bodies have been so scrutinized, and that is the same thing that they're inviting. And to be very specific, to children. Okay. And so that for me is a really pressing issue. And then I know that Jenna also couldn't join today because she's writing. So she's in very intensive edits of this beautiful piece that I can't say what it's about, but I promise you it's really exciting. And she's also starting a book, working on her book this summer. So those are the things that feel really prescient.
Wonderful. Okay. And so then I guess in a shorter term kind of way, what types of things are getting you through the moment, so you can stay focused on the future?
The things that are keeping me focused in the moment, I would say friends. Like I've been really, I'm a Leo, as you know. And one of the big things of I think that's the truest of being a Leo is like, family and friend networks are very, very critical to our mental mm-hmm. health and well-being.
Oh, and yes. Wow. Yes.
And obviously in this pandemic context, those things are put into such a tender space. You know, today I'm sitting in mourning of a family member who just passed away from COVID. And
I'm sorry to hear that.
And I'm thinking so much about, yeah, just how to hold all those truths and really just like making it a duty to be really real with people and be really close with people, and not like close, although sometimes that's nice, but I'm just really tired of shrinking. And I think that so many of us who work institutionally know exactly what I mean by that. I just don't have, the patience for smallness when our people are disproportionately dying or being killed, you know? And I think it's just a matter of like, yeah, I am looking forward to the table flipping. That's what keeps me excited. And as a true Leo who truly loves chaos, I'm like, let's fuck it up, you know? Like,
burn it down.
or not burn it down. I don't like to burn it down. I do like the like, let's reorganize.
Let's reorient.
I love a librarian saying burn it down. You always talk about burn it down. You're talking about conserve it, first of all. So let's just be real. I feel, you know, what you said is right. I'm all here for rage, and I don't mean to quiet that rage, but I also, more specifically, I'm talking about what we personally do in our own like ways of being interpersonally. Systems, fuck, like burn the systems, but don't burn ourselves is what I'm saying.
Keep us, how are we keeping us whole? So yeah, you are absolutely right. For Leos, yes, especially like, I feel like I saw something on Twitter that said Leos, it's for Leos, having people around is like, it's like a fire where it's like, you're like, I love the warmth. I love being around all these people. It gives the vibes. And absolutely being in pandemic time was certainly challenging. So challenging for mental health. If you were someone who was used to going out and you're used to being around people, you get your energy from just being around people and hearing them talk and hearing their ideas. So yeah, that's really, I was thinking about that, you know, simply because this book was something that got me through all of the coverage of the trial a couple of weeks back. But yes, also thinking that, you know, as you said, the work is always the work. There's so much work that still has to be done. So how do we stay rooted in our communities? I believe very strongly that, yeah, being able to stay close, like, you know, with your family, with your friends, with people who are really, you know, holding you up, but also keeping you accountable. That is the grounding thing more than any like Netflix binge or, you know, IG. I'm probably like fooling around on IG stories way too much, doing too much in there as a means of maybe quieting some of that. But yes, 2021, we don't have the patience for smallness. I'm so here for that. I love that.
Baby, I'm just, you know, not to cut be problematic and quote RuPaul, but if you ain't gonna love yourself, how the hell you gonna love anybody else?
Like, yeah, I am. How are you gonna do that for anybody else?
I'm so here in that so deeply because I'm so sick of my own bullshit. Like, I'm tired of myself.
Can we look? I feel like maybe there's probably other Leos watching this where they're like, oh, pandemic time, it was so real.
It's too much time for self-reflection. What has felt really like, and of course you're, you know, checking in from yes, Gemini's no too. Checking in from Chicago, what are some of the things that feel really important to you and your community right now? I mean, I'm sure it's a bajillion things, but.
Well, it's, you know, what I'm so inspired by here in Chicago really are the youth. You know, just even thinking back about Miriam Kaba's collection, she worked very closely with the group of young folks here representing No Cop Academy. It was a group of students who advocated very hard to get the city to try to stop the city from building like a 90-something million dollar police training academy, as opposed to taking the money and spending it on schools. And those young people went so hard. They wrote up their surveys, and they were working with adult mentors who helped them like gather data from residents to say, how do you personally want to interact with police in your community? Not like what everybody's telling you need, but what do you want? How do you want to interact? They got all that data, they wrote it up, they analyzed it, they had an awesome report, they sent it downstate, but then they were also doing really hardcore like protest acts around town. And it just, it was so amazing to see. It makes me really excited to be raising children in a city where these young people see what's going on and they know what's up and they are not here for the bullshit. They're not here for it. So I'm very, yeah, that's, I think that's definitely a thing here in Chicago where I'm like, what are the young people doing? Like, they know what's going on. They're like, they're so on point. And I just want them to have all of the things that they need to continue flourishing, to continue growing, to continue learning. So, you know, whatever certainly we can do in this capacity in the library, but I think just also from a personal standpoint, what am I doing in my neighborhood? What am I doing in my general community? What am I doing with the folks with whom I am in, you know, close relationship with, and how, you know, how do we best want to move forward? That's such a great question. I love bragging on Chicago, FYI. Cool. I will brag on Chicago all day. Black Paradise. Yes, Laverne Gray. I see you in the chat. Shout out to Laverne.
I have to tell you a funny story about Chicago, because the first time I went to Chicago, I very intentionally went in December because I was like, I know I'm going to go to Chicago and I'm not going to go back to New York. And I was like, I went and I did a conversation at the MCA Chicago and was like, it's so cold. It's so cold. And I don't know how y'all do it. Like,
We cold. It's just cold. I have to move.
I don't get it. I don't get it. Same for Detroit. I was like, y'all are all, I mean, my family's from Ohio, so, and Missouri. So I'm like very Midwest.
You know the Midwest.
I'm just like, Damn, it's not right. But I do love a fur, you know.
That was what I was going to say. I remembered. I don't even know why I remember this. It was some old photo of you on IG. Maybe it was you and Jenna. You all had these minks on. And I was just like, yes, that's how you're supposed to do it. So yes, Chicago style. You all come back anytime. You know, the minks reign supreme. They reign supreme here. My favorite thing about Chicago actually was just seeing how many women always had the fur coats on. But then, so like, if they were downtown, they'd have these tennis shoes on. Like, I have somewhere to be. But
tennis I'm shoes. Oh, so Midwest.
They're like, I have somewhere to be. I have this mink, but I do need to move quickly. Yes. Yeah. Very, very Chicago, very Chicago. Okay. I feel like I'm not sure where Burgess might be. If they're opening it up for the questions right now, it feels like there are all types of things happening in the chat.
Thank you all. Grab my charger.
Thank you all too so much for sharing all these links to collections and to people and to things. This is really great, really interactive. We're so appreciative. I'm looking in the chat here for some of the questions. Okay. So when Kimberly gets back, we'll jump into the Q&A. It looks like you all have some good ones.
Okay, I'm ready.
Okay. All right. So question one. Let me see here. From Kanita Stringer Standback. So she said, your book is titled Black Futures and not Afrofuturism, a term that we didn't necessarily create. How do we flip the narrative and continue to name ourselves? It's critical that we're creating the language that describes our experience. Do you have other terms that describe Black futures within the technological or sci-fi landscape?
Yeah. You know, when I think of Afrofuturism, I always think of Yatasha Womack, and that might be my mistake. I never thought about it being oriented any other way. Black Futures is a title that both Jenna and I came to, and Mark Derry, thank you, and Mark Derry, that we came to, and I feel really good about. But it's not necessarily oriented toward technology, capital T. It's more like the most analog thing about this book is actually the title, because it really is so much more about thinking of like collective Black futures, like the futures of Black people. And it's really kind of directly inspired by the kind of civil rights era adage of like, we shall overcome. Like we thought about that as like such a deeply Afrofuturist sentiment, like it's just, that's what it is. And so it's not so technically Afrofuturist in its conceptualization, but we do have Rashida Phillips, we do have Black Quantum Futurism, we do have Andre Brock, who I know is also a part of this conference. We have Tabitha Rosaire. We do have people who operate at those intersections of Blackness and technology in many different ways. Rawia Kamir in here as well. Radon Tekley, Lamia Sega, Simone Brown. But Black Futures really is more about like we Black people together, multiple futures is what we're trying to do. You're muted.
Sorry about that. So someone, Cheseray Jenkins, next question. She says, are there plans for another edition or follow-up? It definitely sounds like you all had a lot of material.
This book came out in December and we've worked on it for 5 years. No, I'm just kidding. No, I mean, I think for right now, we're just like, you know, working on this. Still, you know, we put out our book in December and we're still doing events almost weekly to talk about it with people whenever we're invited. And so I think the work of the book is kind of ongoing, but it won't necessarily, it doesn't, I mean, not right now, is it arriving in the form of another book?
Okay, and then we've got a question from Dimitri Broxton. It says, Kimberly, thanks to you and Jenna for this project. Do you imagine this project continuing as a museum exhibition or having another type of extension?
Never.
Love it.
But what's interesting though is, which is not our project, but I do want to shout out, there's a collective of Black digital artists called One Off. And they, not necessarily in relationship to this book, but to the, you know, concept of like Black futures, like broadest sense. They curated a beautiful exhibition in the metaverse at NFTs. And so they have an exhibition that's amazing if you're interested in that. Because I'm fascinated by all those things right now. And their Instagram is XX1OFF. But they're fabulous.
Wonderful. I'm not seeing necessarily any more questions. We're at 3:30. Certainly if there are others, feel free to stop in the chat, but on my end, this has just been such a pleasure. Thank you so much, Kimberly, for meeting. This was fantastic. I hope everyone else enjoyed. Thank you again so much. All the organizers, Archiving the Black Web. Hope you all continue to enjoy the rest of the conversation. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Stacey. Thank you, Burgess. Thank you, everyone whose beautiful hands, everything from the grant writing to this happening is such a gift. Like, I've just been so enjoying being an attendee, and I'm so honored that I get to turn my camera on and say words to you all. This is, let's do it again soon.
Let's do it again soon.
Can we stop? Just because I want to ask a couple questions. I'm sorry, I was trying to give space to the community as well, but I have my homegirl with me right here too. Homegirls. So I feel bad about it, but since she's my homegirl, you can see I got greasy fingerprints on the
look. Look, it's meant to be greasy. I was talking talking to someone on the internet, and they were like, "I don't let my kids touch it because I don't want their fingers on it." This book is supposed to be greasy. You heard it here first.
Well, I feel bad about it now because, you know, a little moisture is okay. You know, I won't.
More is definitely greasy.
I brand archivist of bending pages and stuff like this. But I see you have like a little sticky studio. I was like, God, yes. I got fingerprints all over it. But I'm happy to have this in my collection. It is a wonderful, if you don't have it already, please add it to the collections in your libraries. Add it to your collection. It is on my table next to my book, Why am I blanking on her name? The sister that's the artist that does all the quilting work. Why am I blanking on her name? Beautiful quilting work. She had an exhibition in Chicago that, of course, COVID didn't allow me to.
Bisa
Butler. Thank you.
She's from Jersey.
Yes. And so I'm just honored that you are here with us today. And we send all of our well wishes to Jenna and her project. And certainly, someone told me to ask you about the NFTs. Any information you want to share about that?
I am absolutely not the person to talk to about it. But I do also want to say, and I'm not sure if I'm allowed to say this publicly, but we are making a lower cost version of this book, trying to acquire it for collections. So stay tuned for that before the year is out. Don't tell anyone I told you that. But it's something that we were really thinking about so that we can make it more accessible to folks. And in the realm of NFTs, I mean, what do you want to know? There's so much to talk about.
I mean, just to talk about them, just very briefly, or because some folks might not be up on it. I know it might be a new thing folks are talking about, and Clubhouse too, all of the.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was going to say Clubhouse is like the best place for learning about it. There's a ton of different groups that are having those kinds of conversations there. I personally don't do well on Clubhouse. I find it to be like, it just doesn't work with my sensory whatever's, like it throws all my calibration off. But I will say that what I will shout out is Tiana Nakia McLaudin, who is an artist in Philadelphia, runs a space called Conceptual Fade. And Tiana is mounting an exhibition of NFTs. And Tiana is a great person to follow in that space. Her website is tianam.com. And the space that she runs is Conceptual Fade. And you can just search conceptual, like art, fade, like fade, in Instagram and find it. But what I will say on a very base level, what fascinates me about NFTs is that it hints at a larger conversation in the art world around ownership. Because there was a point in probably the 70s or 80s in which the market price for artworks changed significantly. And it started with a Robert Rauschenberg work. And you saw this incredible kind of chasm of cost and fees in relationship to artworks. And within the art world, there's a primary market, which is if I sell you something. And then there's a secondary market if the person who bought that thing sells it again. And then there's a tertiary market, which is like auctions. Well, secondary and tertiary are both auctions. But once it enters into the secondary market, artists stop receiving payments in relationship to their work. So take, for example, the Carrie James Marshall piece, which sold for $25 million. Carrie didn't see that money until the group of people who bought that painting decided to remit payment to him. And what is interesting in the hope for NFTs, and we're not exactly there yet, is that there would be an opportunity for artists to continue to make money on their things. And that can be albums, that can be poems, that can be artworks, because we talk about NFTs usually as artworks, but that art is much more broad than that. But I find it to be a fascinating arena, as with any other conversation about digital anything, because it is really built from nothing in some ways. And so there's opportunity to think more equitably, to invite more people to the table, to just do better than we've been doing. And for me, I've been writing privately about digital art for the last 6 years. And so I'm really fascinated by the opportunity for, especially for marginalized artists and artists from the global South, to be able to have the resources to create and then also maybe to remunerate on the works that they create.
Yeah, this sort of reminds me of conversations maybe 10 years ago, or maybe not, but the photography of Mardi Gras Indians in New Orleans and how, you know, they spend years and are working on their costumes and their masking and stuff. And then people come take pictures and then they make money off of actually the art that they're photographing. So yes, the continuing kind of conversation around creating equity and folks being able to continue. You're still enjoying the artwork, so there should be some kind of benefit to the creator of it. So,
I mean, and then that makes me think also, and I know we're like running out of time, but I also just want to shout out Nicole Fleetwood's work in Marking Time, because if we really want to talk about the disadvantage of artwork being sold and moved in the world, like, I think Nicole writes so beautifully about this in relationship to incarcerated artists and artists who are working, you know, post-incarceration. But Marking Time, incredible book, came out on Harvard Press. Everybody needs it. Everybody needs to follow Nicole. First of all, she's fine as hell. She's hot and she's smart. And she's so kind, and she is just.
I can co-sign also that when I was at the Schomburg, she was. I met her. She was a fellow down at on the Schwartzman Building, and just a really kind, warm person. And so I'm very happy to see her book doing so well. And yeah. So I guess we can end. I don't want to, but it's been really wonderful. We'll move on to our next panel. What is our next panel? We're talking to our partners on this project. So it'll be me and some other folks chopping it up, talking about where we envision and how we take all of this energy and excitement and actually create the framework that we're hoping to do with archiving the Black web. So I appreciate you all so very much. Thank you for giving your time. I'm glad that we spent this Friday together, and stick around for our next session that starts in about 15 minutes. So you'll actually get to hear a little bit more of DJ Nooney, but it'll be pre-recorded. But anyhow, y'all be safe. Love you. Need a
She is a queen and her body's a blessing. One day they'll convene you to teach mankind a lesson. Cause right now I see power when I see her midsection.
Move! Did I want to see? Stand up against the body. Don't just look at me. Come on, let's talk about it. Treat her like you can. If you know you can't live without her. Shit is all over TV. Outside the streets are crowded.
Yeah. deposit young money and you get cash money. I'm Tunchy the boss. And live from the vault, it's Bus a Bus.
Y'all, swag mania, pop the ghost most, carry the most beautiful bitches with us happily toast. Keep the faculty close, gross when we give them a dose. Got them OD and leaning in each coast, seen